name is Mark Berretini, and I'm the director of the School of Theater and Film. Thanks to you all for coming out. We really appreciate it. Thanks to Mark for coming for the last couple of days. He's been visiting classes and doing this event for us, so we really appreciate that.
You're welcome.
Glad to be here.
Great. Let us know if we're all right with the mics. I won't do a hot mic joke. That's what I just did. So we're going to start with some questions and see how we do, and kind of go through some of your work and talk a bit about that. Great.
You ready for my sequel to Downton Abbey? As you can see, it's in my real world.
Just like, so we have a range of students and community members. You could just sort of talk a little bit about your professional start and kind of give us a sense of how you got from Portland State to your current position.
Well, that may take a minute. So I grew up in Portland. I grew up in Aloha and went to Aloha High School and came to Portland State. When I was a kid, I loved comic books and science fiction, and I was a collector and a fan. I also loved movies. But growing up in Aloha, Oregon, I wasn't quite sure how to turn that into a profession or how to actually do that for a living. I also always loved writing, and I was lucky that from when I was 5 years old on, I knew I wanted to be a writer. So kind of everything was focused toward that from that moment on, making films, filmmaking, that sort of thing. When I was about 14, I started what was called an Amateur Press Alliance, which is basically a group of like-minded, in my case, comic book fans, who would write little magazines, send them to a central guy who was me. I'd staple them together and send them out to everybody. And through that, I met a lot of really interesting people. I met Mike Richardson, who's back there, who runs Dark Horse Comics. I met Paul Chadwick, who created Concrete. Randy Stradley, who was one of the early members of Dark Horse. And these all became sort of a group of friends. We all wanted to break into the business together. So, and Frank Miller actually was an early member, although he didn't live here, he lived in Vermont. I came here to study film. My first student film was actually written by Frank Miller, so I did his first film.
Which is a good start.
Yeah. You haven't seen it. What was great about Portland State back then, which was a much smaller program then than it is now, is what was great about it for me is that it was access to equipment, it was access to a teacher who was not judgmental but would tell us how to edit and cut and do stuff like that. And it was also a place where you had to be very self-motivated because there was no money to make your films or anything like that. So. A bunch of us who went to Portland State in that era, 74 to 78, ended up moving to Los Angeles sooner or later. And I'm friends with many of them to this day. However, there still weren't too many film opportunities in Portland back then. So I moved to Los Angeles in 1983 and got a day job at the Los Angeles Times. And while I was doing that, I started writing freelance screenplays. And sold one for $500, which was the best $500 I'd ever made. Sold another one for $3,000. That actually got made. Don't look for it. Don't. Actually played on HBO, of all things. But and then Dark Horse started. Of course, I had to leave town before they would start. I was friends with Randy and with Mike and a number of people over there, Chris Warner. And they asked me to contribute something, so I started writing comics for them. And this is getting very long-winded, but basically the comics led back into film. And with Mike, we pitched Time Cop to Sam Raimi, and he produced that. The Mask came after that, Inline. It was fun for all of us, I think. It was 2 number one movies in 2 months. I thought, I like this film business. And then I discovered that's not really how it always works. And from there, I just sort of kept working. And that's just a process of, I've written a lot of scripts. I've sold about 23. 3 have been made. So that gives you an idea of how many features get made. And I've worked on, I don't know how many shows, like 13 or 14 shows. Produced and written like 9. And continues to be fun, so I keep doing it. People are dumb enough to hire me, so I keep doing it.
And you made your transition into TV, I remember you told us yesterday.
TV happened. We had done the movie Time Cop, and Larry Gordon, who produced it, quite sure how this happened, but had managed to get a deal at ABC. They gave us an on-air order of 13 on the air. And so I was to write the pilot. Now, I had never done television, so this was just out of the blue, boom. So we did 9 episodes of the Time Cop TV show, because I quickly learned that 13 on the air doesn't really mean too much if they don't like the show. And so it was canceled after 9. But it was a good learning experience, sort of. Then I did some more features and ended up doing another show called The Strip, which in some ways was the most fun of a show I ever had, because it was set in Vegas. And we shot in Vegas, and I got to go to Vegas all the time. Another one that was canceled after 9. So we had fun, the audience didn't. And then I moved on to Smallville. And that one ended up sort of being one that lasted 10 years. I was on for the first 3 years. A career is really about just sort of opportunity, putting yourself being in a place where opportunity can knock and you can take it. And so being in LA and writing a lot and getting to know people as I was working on different projects, people get to know you and you keep getting sort of asked to jobs, which is fantastic. And that's really sort of how my career has gone along. Most of the time I get calls and people will say, well, would you be interested in doing this show? And I say yes, or I say no. But it took 15 years to get there. So it's not like you just walk in and that happens. So that's sort of how it happened.
Keeping with that a little bit, we had talked earlier. So there are lots of them, of course, but a moment that you feel like this was an essential moment in your career looking back now to get where you are, and on the other end of it, is there a moment that you would have done differently? Again, moments are hard.
Right, yeah. I mean, there's moments. I mean, obviously working for Dark Horse has been great, and they gave me my break, so that was fantastic. I think selling that first studio script to Warner Brothers was a seminal moment, because I've been trying and trying, and I was making little tiny bits of money here and there, but that was a real moment. I think the real moment, though, was when I sold the first script. When you sell a studio script, you have to join the Writers Guild. If you sell it to a guild signatory, that's how it works. So I joined the Writers Guild, and they said, you should come down for our first meeting, where your new members come and learn all about the guild. So I did, and this woman gave this lecture to us about how this will probably be the only script you ever sell. I know, that's cheerful. And in fact, she had only sold one, so maybe it was her experience. But so in some ways, selling the second was the biggest career thing, because then it wasn't just a fluke, it was the beginning of a career. So. Joel Silver bought all those. He was a real, he bought a bunch of my early stuff, so that was very nice.
Again, not a bad person to have buying your scripts.
No, he's a good guy.
Yeah. Can you talk a little bit about, I mean, you have different involvements in different television shows, but if you were developing a TV show from sort of your origin, let's say, or your kind of original piece, how do you work on that? What's your process for kind of getting started?
It depends on what the project is. I've been developing some things myself now. One of them is a project where I have the life rights to someone. So obviously that would start with, I look over the person's life, and then I talk to this person has to be dead, so I talk to the heirs, and figure out what's the best way to tell this person's story. Now in this case, it's a big science fiction piece, so we're actually inventing a lot of what that story would be with the permission of the heirs. But so for me, it's sitting down, it's really with a blank screen and going like, what is the story I want to tell? And that would start with sort of a framework. It would start with maybe one page, here's a mission statement. Here's what I don't want to do with the show. And then start expanding that into story ideas. Who are the characters? How do the characters interact? Who might play them? I might pull off the internet pictures of actors who I like that look like the cast, you know, their wish list, like, you know, Tom Cruise or whatever, but it's a wish list where you're saying, this guy is this sort of guy, this guy is this sort of guy. If I was getting really elaborate, I might hire an artist to do pictures, to do illustrations. I've done giant boards where I'll come in with, you know, pictures of all the cast and how they interact with lines going through them. Anything to help sort of get across the idea of what the story's about to the buyer, because you're going in blind. They have no idea what you're doing. So the idea here is to come in with as much as you can to convince them they should buy this. But I don't want to ever go in until I'm happy with it, where I feel like my rule now actually is I would buy it. In other words, it's not like I'm half done or half baked. I want to go in and this is kind of strange, I don't expect to sell it. What I want to do is make sure that I didn't blow it. In other words, I did the best job possible pitching it. You can't sell everything you pitch. But I don't want to go walk out of the room saying that didn't sell because I forgot this or I didn't do that. So it can be a long process. And for pitches for films, I'll write the entire pitch. They can be like 7 pages and I'll memorize it like a stand-up comic and then we'll do it. When Mike and I took Time Cop around, we had a pitch. I remember pitching that like 20 times, and by the time I got to the 20th, that was a pretty good pitch, because I knew where the laugh lines were. By the way, pretty close to the movie. I knew where people would smile, I knew where they'd say, what happened? It's going back in time, what's going on? And we, you know, finally sold it to Sam Raimi, or got it to Sam Raimi, he was able to set it up in a studio. So.
This is a totally off the list question here. Did you write that with Van Damme in mind?
That's an excellent question. I believe we had, well, in my mind, we had Kurt Russell in mind. Kurt Russell, was it?
Yeah.
The American Van Damme.
Yes. Yes. The one who can act. So, he's all right. That's a funny story. That's a funny story because we pitched Kurt Russell for Time Cop, and they said he hasn't done anything in a while, and blah blah blah. And Time Cop came out and did okay, and then Stargate came out, and his career just blew up, and suddenly that wouldn't have been such a bad idea. Look, I think, I joke about Van Damme, I actually think he's fine in this. He is what he is. So you take that and build the story that works with that sort of guy. By the way, I scripted those splits, so that's not something you made up. I knew he could do them because I'd watched his other movies and I'd seen him actually do them. And that's, it's one of the few stunts it's actually his. So if you watch the movie, there's a lot of stuff for this other dude's doing.
The question sort of came to my mind when I saw that clip because I thought, there's not a lot of actors that you could write that for. And then I thought maybe he just improv'd because.
No, we were scripted. All that stuff, the water bottle and all that, that was all scripted. Yeah.
Yesterday, I think in class, we talked a little bit about audience, and I want to tweak that a little bit. So when you're writing a project, when you're beginning to kind of plan something out, and obviously this is, I think, different for pre-existing property like Daredevil, but feel free to talk about that as well. Mm-hmm. How much time do you spend thinking about the narrative, kind of narrative arc, in relation to sort of the conventions of the genre, the requirements of the show, the requirements of the genre, and thinking about for some of the writers in the audience, like, if you're going to make a, you know, Daredevil type show, you got to do this, this, and this, and you don't want to do this, this, and this kind of thing.
Well, I think if you're doing a pre-existing character like Daredevil, you you want to be true to the character that's in the comic. So Marvel and Netflix are very involved in these shows, and so they have a an interest in making sure that we do the show that represents that character in the way that they want it to be represented. By the way, that's the deal going in. That's not a good or bad thing. That's just what it is. So in a situation like that, or like with season two of Daredevil, you know, we walked in knowing we wanted to do, but I don't want to get into spoilers, but so I don't know who's seen it or not seen it, but too bad, I'll ruin it for you. We wanted to do the Punisher, we wanted to do Elektra, and we knew we had certain cast members coming back for a certain number of episodes. So it was up to us to figure out where we wanted to put them and then schedule them. So those were sort of the prerequisites of it. And then it was about how do we do a story that's true to those characters, that's true to the characters that we like. Comics are funny. Daredevil's had a million different incarnations. Our Daredevil doesn't kill anybody. There's been comics where he does. The Punisher has gone from a complete villain to sort of a mercenary guy fighting overseas to a complete psycho shooting everybody. So we wanted to do a version, I think, of him where we understood sort of humanity behind the really terrible stuff he does. We had a lot of discussions about that and about sort of how far or not, how far to go with that. And then with Elektra, we really wanted to be true to Elektra. I mean, obviously there's a Daredevil movie, there's an Elektra movie. I don't know if you've seen them, you know, you can have your opinions. We certainly saw them, and we wanted to do something that was our take and not those takes. So, but it's not really complicated. We kind of sit down at page one and go like, okay, here's what we've got. What's the stories we want to tell? How do we want to tell them? And in this case, Daredevil, we told it in sort of three pieces. So there's like three acts in Daredevil season two. It's the Punisher, it's the trial of the Punisher and meeting Elektra, and it's all that coming together at the end. So, and then, you know, there's no mystery to writing scripts. You go into the writer's room with a bunch of people and you throw around ideas and the best idea wins and you slowly start building out a story and then write outlines and write scripts and get notes and budget it and get in all that if you want. But there's a whole process involved in that, being mindful of what you can or can't do budget-wise.
And building off that to some extent, are you interested in talking a little bit about how intellectual property plays in the current market and how intellectual properties plays in the current market? You talked a little bit to some of the students about that.
Well, I think, you know, obviously it's a very busy market. There's 410 scripted shows or something like that, and all the movies and all the other media and video games and everything and the internet. So, what you get with a property like Daredevil is something that has a name recognition. There's an IP that I actually kind of get tired of IP as a, it just feels so like not creative. Like, I got the IP, you know.
When people first started saying that, I was always like, IP address? Like, what are they talking about?
Right. But it's someone else's property, but it has a certain name value. So I think, you know, it helps you break through the clutter. In terms of, so that's the value of that. It's hard, frankly, to set up an original property. It's not impossible, they happen all the time. Breaking Bad was original, you know, so they happen all the time. But those are definitely harder than getting on a show that has some pre-existing thing. The whole point of that is that studio executives, wonderful people they are not particularly known for their, how should I put this, courage. So they would like to know that someone else has liked it before they get to like it. And obviously Marvel stuff's been around forever. So that's the value of it.
And with that, the Marvel properties, let's say, the potential for intellectual property like Marvel, of course, is all the different ways they can connect now, and the different modes of distribution they can create different properties.
Well, Marvel's trying something sort of new in that they're trying to make it's not new to comics. It's a combined universe where all this stuff sort of merges, and you know, there's aspects of Daredevil's very out of the sort of Marvel mainstream in terms of the other movies, but there are nods to it. Like, you know, a building fell down in season one that was part of the Avengers. And so there's a little, I guess there are, you know, Easter eggs more than anything else. Our universe that the Marvel shows are, I think, they're all Hell's Kitchen, they're all New York, and they're more so gritty and I guess real in quotes. And so those are definitely all interconnected. And so it's no mystery they're doing a show right now called The Defenders, which is Daredevil, Luke Cage, Iron Fist, Elektra, I forget who else is in it, Jessica Jones, those guys. So that's a property that, that's what they've done. They've taken all their shows and sort of made a synergy out of that. And they're going to do that big show.
And then they have the ability to do that.
Right, and they'll keep doing all the solo shows too. So that universe, I think, is going to keep expanding just because it's very successful. And I don't know that that's been done in film before. So it's been done in TV, but not in TV.
Universe. I feel like, I don't know, I'm talking to students and some other folks who teach here, and I don't think we've come up with anything that looks like Marvel in the way that it's working between film and television, and some of that parallels the comics, but the kind of, you know, dipping in and out of narratives that, if you're really being like a completist, I guess, you're watching all of these,
right,
even for the small connections that,
right,
they have.
If you're a fan of the shows, you'd want to watch all of them, and you get little bits and pieces that fit into the parts of the other shows.
Right.
So, it's kind of unique and an interesting thing to be part of.
Also unique and interesting in your career, to me and to many other people, I'm sure, is working with Netflix and thinking about new modes of exhibition distribution.
Right.
So I was wondering if you would talk a little bit about that and sort of, you know, what that experience is like, and also to some extent, if you want to speculate, what you think that landscape in terms of distribution and exhibition kind of looks like,
right,
going forward. We were talking earlier, you know, and some of you have heard this, so sorry, but, you know, like in my day, but
right,
that sense of it was, you made a film, you circulated it, and tried to get into theaters, and that was sort of
right. That was the, yeah, I mean, there were, you know, 12 channels, maybe.
Right.
You know.
And I was saying, Mark, too, like, the idea of being on a TV show when I was in school was sort of like, how, you might as well send me to Mars. Like, how does anybody work on a TV show? Like, what's that mean?
Right. Well, from a production standpoint, working for Netflix is no different than doing a TV show anywhere else. It's budgeted, and you do your number of episodes. So in that sense, just in the sheer physical, practical way you do it, it's not any different. In a creative sense, what's different, and what's fantastic for me as a writer, is first, there's no act breaks like commercial television. So I don't have to write to commercials. I don't have to worry about that. And if you watch modern television, some shows now have 7 act breaks for commercials. That is such an artificial, impossible, dramatic criteria to put on you as you're trying to figure out a story. You're doing 2-minute acts, whereas you're supposed to have little pops to bring you back. So there's that. I'm glad we're not doing that. Another great thing about a Netflix or Amazon or the other ones is that there's no time limit. And it's not the time limit out, it's the time limit back. When we did Battlestar, often our shows would come in, our cuts would come in 15 minutes long, 20 minutes long. Well, we had 42 minutes, period. So that meant we had to cut out big chunks of show that, you know, often felt to a lot of us that we were cutting out stuff that you could lose because it wasn't totally essential, but was the emotional stuff. It was the fun, you know, character moment between people. We don't have to worry about that on Netflix. You can let it run as long as you want. And the one thing I miss on Netflix, which I liked about regular TV, is the week-to-week of showing something. You know, we spent a year on Daredevil. It comes out in one day. A lot of people watch it in one day. That's it. One of the fun things of being on Battlestar was every week people would watch it, you'd see all the internet stuff and the reviews and what's going to happen next. And so I missed that a little bit, but not enough to trade it for those other things. But for me as a viewer, like you guys, I'm sure binging is great. I mean, it's great. No commercials, just keep rocking and rolling. And that's how I watch most of my stuff now.
And you were saying, I think, previously, you know, if you were speculating next, I don't know what the time frame I would put on it. 5 to 10 years, more obviously more and more material is going to be streamed.
Right. Well, are you asking about the future of network television?
Yeah, sure.
I suppose I'm a little bit of a pessimist in the sense that I'm not sure how the economic model of making a network show, given the ratings that they're getting and what they're getting for advertising, how that keeps going. So I'm just not sure how that keeps going. I think if I were to guess, I would guess network television goes more toward day and date stuff. You have to watch on the day. So American Idol or news or sports, stuff like that. And I think there'd still be a few big shows, but they're so hamstrung on the networks by not censors, but you know, by standards and practices and stuff, because it goes out to everybody. And the FCC frowns on some of the language that was in this.
Right.
So that would be sort of one of my guesses. There are 410 scripted shows right now. I'm not sure how much longer that can go. I hope forever. I hope there's 800 shows soon, because I'd like to keep working. Some people are saying it's peak TV. Maybe you've heard that, this peak TV thing. Who knows? I don't know. I don't know how they're financing them now. I don't care. So
that's not. Yeah.
I care a little bit, but not that much.
Yeah, and was it the head of Hulu who said that about peak TV? I don't remember.
It was, I think, the head of FX.
FX. Okay.
Yeah. They do a lot of shows, so
right.
Take yours off the air, buddy.
That's always the solution. We also have lots of students in the audience, which is great. Thank you, students. And I will ask the question that many of them, I'm sure, are asking or want to ask, which is, what are some of the ways that you think someone who's just starting out is really going to be able to kind of launch themselves?
Right.
And you and I have talked a little bit about there's a lot of different avenues now.
So. Right. We did talk some about this today. I mean, I think there's a million different avenues, and it sort of depends on what you want to do. I would say 20 years ago when I was breaking it, or 25, you know, it was kind of Hollywood ran things. And so you moved to Hollywood, you wrote. By the way, this is as a writer. I'm not totally familiar with how to break in as a production designer or something like that. You wrote a lot of stuff, you tried to get it to people who could read it, hope they would buy it, and build a career that way. The way to get it into people would be to get a job as an assistant on a show, or to be an assistant to an agent, or to meet somebody at a party. There are a lot of ways. I got my first, those low budget jobs I got was because one of my roommates was doing sound work for a guy for next to nothing. I said, does he need a script? He said, well, I don't know, let me ask him. He asked, he said he does. I went and met with him, he said, write something. So that's how that worked. Nowadays, though, with YouTube and with all these other sort of ways to distribute your stuff, I think there are maybe better ways to sort of create a calling card for yourself, which might be to produce your own 10-minute short or half an hour short. Frankly, these days you can shoot a feature for $5,000, if depending on what it is. You can do a lot on your own now and have that be your calling card, as opposed to the sort of old school way, which is work your way up, kid, and sweep the floors, and then eventually be on a TV show. They're both valid, and it kind of depends on what you want to do. The first one, the sort of old school way, the way I did it, does require, I think, you have to move to Los Angeles. That's pretty much the first step. It's just the business is there. And it's a business of relationships, and it's a business of getting to know people. Once you've been in for a while, you can move back to wherever you want, you know, and fly in and fly out. That's not impossible. But TV is a staff job. I go into an office every day. So that's how that works. You can't do that on Skype, or maybe someday, 3D you in there. But you're not doing that yet. And it's also very much the relationship of everybody in the room and all that kind of stuff. So I guess what I'm saying is I would investigate if moving to Los Angeles is just flat out impossible, or it's just nothing you want to do. And by the way, that's fine. Not everybody loves Los Angeles. Then there's other ways to skin a cat. Mr. Richardson started an entire empire here in Oregon, right? Yep. So, you know, Mike started his own business. That was his way to sort of skin the cat. That's another, and by the way, been great. So, a lot of it's what you want to do. You know, I always wanted to write. I'm not a great businessman. I always just wanted to write. So that was my focus.
And the YouTube, whatever, you know, I'm not even going to, I have my flip phone here, so let's just say it all right there. the YouTube. That route, I mean, if you want to just say a little bit about that, because my concern always with some of the current environment is like, and now I'm really going to just go down this road, this is like the version of, you know, Lana Turner being discovered at the pool at the Beverly Hills Hilton or something like that. That idea that this just happens is really not the case. Even if you're becoming like a YouTube releaser, you still want to hustle.
You do. I mean, you've probably heard this term influencers. I don't know if you've heard that, but there's this new thing of people who get 5,000 or 5 million Twitter followers become influencers. And then what you want is them to like your thing, say something about it, so their 5 million people see that, retweet it to their billions of people. There are studios now that will not make films unless they get influencers involved up front, so they know that they're going to get that sort of social media. But to become an influencer is sort of like becoming an astronaut as well. It's, you know, you just don't decide one day to do that. It takes as much work and as effort as anything else. It's a full-time job. It depends on what you're, again, trying to do. There's, again, you pick your, like if you're someone that wants to make, I'll pick a terrible example, cat videos. There's too many of those already. Some sort of video. Let's say you want to make some sort of
hedgehog videos.
Hedgehog, niche videos. Then you should make them and then find a way to convince people to watch them, build your links to